Okay, my name is Mark Horowitz, and today I'll be talking a little bit about how to create energy-efficient digital systems. Now, as we all know, because of Moore's law, the number of devices that we can print on an integrated circuit has been increasing exponentially. And because of Dennard scaling rules, as we increase the number of devices, not only do we get more devices per unit area, but we also have devices that run faster, so that for every scaling of 2, we get 4 times as many devices. They run twice as fast. But probably the most important part is that the energy it takes to do each gate transition scales down by a factor of 8. What that means is that for every scaling of 2 in technology, we get to do 8 times as many gate evaluations per second in the same area and the same power budget. Okay, and what that means is that we've come to expect that in a number of years, the highest frequency or performance computing that we had could easily now fit in our pocket. So in the 80s, the highest performance computer was a Cray 1. It ran at 80 megahertz and dissipated 110 kilowatts. And today, instead of being at 80 megahertz, we could do that and it would run at a gigahertz, okay? It would fit in a piece of silicon, the entire computer, including the entire memory system, would fit in a couple square millimeters, and now it would dissipate less than a watt. So we get a factor of 10 to the fifth savings in energy by using this technology scaling. And so there's lots of supporting evidence you've probably seen about the increasing performance of integrated circuits. What I've plotted here is just the performance of a microprocessor over the past 30 years from the mid-80s to today. And you see this nice exponential increase where we've increased the performance by about a factor of 10 to the fourth. Now, if you want, there's a website that's called cpudb.stanford.edu that has all the data that you can look at if you would choose. Unfortunately, what you see is that nice smooth scaling is actually a little misleading, because if you look at clock frequency, we saw this period of time up into the mid-2000s where we were dramatically increasing the frequency of microprocessors, but recently that frequency that we have has pretty much leveled out. And you might be wondering why that's happened, and that really comes down to the need for energy efficiency, because during that same period of time that the performance was scaling so dramatically, what you see is that the power dissipation was also scaling up fairly dramatically. And when the clock frequency leveled out, it leveled out because we hit basically the wall in what we could dissipate in power. Now, the important thing to realize on this plot is that what we're really doing is power density, watts per square millimeter. And so this limit up here of 1 watt isn't really 1 watt for chip power dissipation, but really someplace between probably 100 and 200 watts, because most microprocessor chips are a couple hundred millimeters squared. And what you can see is more recently there's been a downward trend in the power density, and that's because of the need for power energy efficiency. In order to understand what went wrong, because after all, Bob Dennard said we should be able to scale these things with constant power density, we need to just review a little bit about the causes of power dissipation in CMOS circuits. As I hope you remember, there are 2 basic causes of power dissipation. The first is what we call the dynamic power, and that's the power taken by charging and discharging a capacitance load through a set of transistors. And the energy for doing a transition of basically charging the capacitor and discharging the capacitor is CV squared. And oftentimes it's called CV squared divided by 2 for each transition. But in addition to the dynamic power, there's static power that's caused because when the input is, let's say, low, the PMOS transistor is on, but the NMOS transistor, which is off, isn't completely off. It has a little bit of leakage current. That leakage current is usually dominated by sub-threshold conduction, and therefore it's exponential on the difference between the VGS and the threshold. When a transistor is off, VGS is generally 0. So the leakage current is exponential on the threshold voltage divided by a sub-threshold slope. And we're going to come back to that in a second because it's very important in terms of why we're in a power problem. Now, if we go back to the plot of frequency, you can see that one of the reasons the power density increased was we were increasing frequency faster than we should have been increasing if we followed Bob Dennard's law. That is, we're increasing it faster than a factor of 2x for every technology generation. So by the time we found ourselves in trouble, we were basically 10x too high in frequency. And because power is equal to CV squared, VDD squared, times the frequency, times some transition, if we're running the frequency at 10x too high, we would expect the power density to increase. But that's not the whole problem. The other problem came about because we should have been scaling power dissipation. Excuse me, power supply proportional to the line width. But if you notice, if we look at the actual data, again from the database I gave you before, you find out that it's not proportional to proportional to the channel length. It was only proportional to channel length divided to the 0.6 power. And that means that because the power supplies were higher than they were before, we end up dissipating a little bit more power. But that's not the biggest problem. The biggest problem is that if you notice, recently power supply voltages have actually leveled out and are no longer scaling. To understand why that's happened, we need to go back to this question about leakage and static power. So on this plot, what we have is basically the scaling of the dynamic power, which we said has been increasing. But if you notice, the leakage power has been increasing even more rapidly. The reason that the leakage power increased more rapidly is we're trying to scale VDD down. But to scale VDD down, we have to scale VTH down. And as we scale VTH down, the leakage current is going to exponentially go up. So initially, when people saw this, there were lots of predictions that the leakage current was going to actually exceed the active power. But that's kind of silly, because we were intentionally increasing leakage power to decrease thresholds to decrease the scaling and dynamic power. So what actually has happened over time is the leakage power and the active power have bent over. But in order for us to stop the leakage power from scaling up, we have to stop scaling threshold voltages. And that means that VDD scaling has to stop. Now, I'm sure many of you have heard about the 3D, the FinFET technology that's been recently announced by all the major semiconductor manufacturers. And this is where you build a very thin piece of silicon and you surround the piece of silicon completely by polysilicon. Now, these two new transistors are much better. They have better sub-threshold slope. And so they will allow us to do a little bit improvement in power because we can lower the thresholds by basically 50 to 100 millivolts. But it's a one-time effect, and we're still going to be stuck with the power supply just being a little lower than it was before. So in summary, what this means is that the basic energy of gates is going to be scaling relatively slowly by technology, mostly by just the scaling factor at best. And because we're power limited in almost everything we build, if we want the performance to increase, which we always do, it means that the energy per operation is going to have to scale down. Okay? So increasing performance requires us to decrease energy per op, and we can no longer rely on technology to do that. So what are our options? The first thing that we need to realize when we try to decrease the energy per op is that there's always a law of diminishing returns when you try to do anything, which means that if I try to make a computer run faster and faster, as I try to make it go faster, the energy required per operation actually increases. Until you get to a point where no matter how hard you try, you can spend infinite energy, and you still can't get it to go any faster. Similarly, as you try to decrease the energy, you can give up infinite performance, and you can't decrease the energy. So you have this law of diminishing returns. Now, what that means is that if we want to be energy efficient, we have to not waste either performance or energy in building this. And this can give an easy explanation about why everything has multiple processors in it. If you look at this trade-off curve that we saw before, and we say, okay, instead of building one processor, I want to get something that, like, at this performance level. Instead of having one processor, if I can basically build four processors, then each processor can run at a lower performance. And at that lower performance, notice the lower energy than it was before. So that means at the same performance, because I have four processors, the total power is going to go down by the difference in energy per op. So I can get higher effective throughput if I can use multiple processors. Of course, this has led people to believe that we're going to scale processors from the 4 or 10-ish we have today into hundreds in the future. But remember, we've already done the scaling, so we're basically someplace here. If we do it again, and now we do this same scaling, the change in energy now is much smaller because we're closer to the law of diminishing returns. So even though we could put four times as many processors, because of the energy limit, we're only saving maybe like a 1.4 in energy now. So we can't use all our four processors. We only can use 1.4 of them, because that's only the energy we're saving per op. OK, so if parallelism isn't going to save us, what other things we can do? Well, clearly, we cannot dissipate energy if we don't need to. So a very popular technique, which is used in all basically digital systems today, is basically clock gating. And in clock gating, what it means is that you don't transition the clocks if you don't need the output. And this is not just to save the clock power, but of course, if the clocks don't change, none of the data changes. So this basically stops all dynamic power. Now, of course, we said that there's dynamic power and leakage power. So if we stop all the dynamic power, now the leakage power can be a big problem. And this is a huge issue in cell phones and other things that have to work on a battery. So not only do we stop the clocks today, but we actually turn off the power supplies by putting either switches or doing the switching regulators to set those supplies to zero to stop not only the dynamic power, but the static power as well. Now, that's not enough, because we've been doing those kinds of things for many years. Most of the processors or energy efficient systems already do that. So what we're starting to do is trying to decrease the power supply even more than that. So typically, what happens when you have a power supply voltage, there is some margin in that power supply voltage to handle variations in the power supply. So if we really need to be at VDD star, we are going to increase that by some amount so that if the power supply ever has a transient, the lowest it ever goes is still above VDD star. But if you do that, notice we're wasting, in most situations, some voltage, which is causing excess energy. So in modern microprocessors, what they do is they actually run, closer to VDD star. And if they detect this voltage drop, what they do is they change the clock frequency for a short period of time so that when the power supply is lower, you can still get the correct answer. And by doing this, you save maybe 10% or so in the VDD, which saves you about 20% in energy. So we are starting to really not only remove waste in useless transitions, but we're trying to remove waste in basically margins as well. OK, but we've been starting to implement all those. So now we're down to trying to even find new ways to reduce waste. And one of the biggest wastes that remains is what I'll call algorithmic waste, which is to realize that the best way to save energy is to actually do less work. Because if you do less work, first of all, obviously the energy is going to go down because you're doing less operations. But not only that, you're going to appear to go faster because you're doing less operations, so you're done with the overall tasks sooner. And so what that means is that by changing the algorithm or changing the hardware, you can make dramatic improvement in the energy per operation for the higher level operation. And I would say that the leading edge today in building very energy efficient systems is to do this kind of algorithmic optimization. So in conclusion, I think today energy per operation is the most important thing that designers struggle with, because it's the only way that we're going to be able to increase the overall performance. Okay, technology, unfortunately, is no longer going to really make dramatic changes in the energy per operation. And as a result, we are going to have to, as designers, decrease the energy per operation by leveraging parallelism whenever possible, by basically trying to remove all sorts of energy waste, whether it's spurious transitions excess leakage or even margins that we put in the design. And finally, I think in the future, we're going to have to rely more and more on tailoring the application and the hardware together to basically remove algorithmic waste. Thank you all for your attention.